Before we start, I would like you to open your Bibles to John. We're going to study Romans, but I want to read a couple of texts. John 15. And I'm going to read a couple of texts and then have a word of prayer that God will guide our thinking and my thoughts. I have no notes. I'm just trusting the Holy Spirit to guide me through a book that I've studied for many years. And I always claim this text before ever, anytime I preach, give a lecture, give a presentation, this is a text that the Lord and I always go over together. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, how does it read? You can ask whatever you wish, and it will be granted you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. Now let's go over one more text. Turn the page in mine to John 16:13. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, and here's a promise, he will guide you into all truth. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Let's pray. Father, as we open up this wonderful book of Romans, we ask and we claim the promise we just read. We ask that you would guide our thinking, guide my words, and Father, bless those who read. May the Holy Spirit interpret to them just what they need. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, the book of Romans is one of my favorite books. That and Galatians and John have a lot of favorite books. But the book of Romans is uniquely applicable to transitioning Seventh-day Adventists. It is the book that you need to understand, as well as Galatians. And the background is that Paul was writing to the church in Rome, which was a mixed church. It had Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians. And the issue was, once you become a Christian, where does the law fit in? And Paul was preaching that we're saved without even reference to the law. And then, as we are accused often, they would say, okay, you're an antinomian, just go out and live in sin. And one place Paul says that as sin increased, what happened? Grace abounded all the more. And in the early church, there were actually some people that went down that road, and they said, let's sin. You know, great, let's just go out and sin so we can experience the fullness of God's grace. Okay, so Adventists need to face the same problem. You come to Christ just as you are, and you're saved by faith. Then what about the law? And Adventists would say, now you're in a position to really start to obey the law. And those of us who come from Adventism know that the law is the paradigm of the Adventist church. They have the Ten Commandments before the fall of man. And when Christ comes, you know, the Ten Commandments appear up in the sky. And the final thing in great controversy is that everybody understands God's law. It's law-focused, law-oriented. All right, with that background, let's jump into Romans. And the time we have, we'll do the best we can. We won't get all the way as where I thought we could get, but we'll do the best. Paul says in chapter 1 that he was set apart for the gospel of God. I'm going to skip a lot of verses, but follow along. So what is the gospel? Verse 3, concerning his son. What's the gospel about? Jesus. It's about Jesus, okay? Now, there's usually a book of Paul's especially, he will basically tell you what's coming so you can alert yourself to the key theme. Verse 5, through whom we have received grace and apostleship. Now notice the next sentence. To bring about the obedience of what? The obedience of faith. Would you say that out loud? The obedience of faith. He's not leading them into sin. He's not leading them into the obedience to the law. He's leading them into what? Obedience of faith. Okay, that, you know, I don't know if you underline your Bibles, but I do. Anyway, that's key because that's going to be the theme that he's talking about. How you can be saved by grace without anything to do with the law and yet be obedient to a higher law, the moral principles of God. All right, now, let's go to 16. This is the theme. This is the major theme of the book. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it, that is the gospel, is the power or dynamite of God for salvation to everyone who believes. Now, do you really believe that? What about if you just caught in the act of adultery? Can you be saved? What if you just murdered a person? Could you be saved? What if you just robbed a bank? Could you be saved? See, we have to read it. It's to everybody who believes. Now, belief is more than just intellectual assent. It's belief and
trust.
Okay. So anytime you hear the word faith or belief, they come from the same Greek words. It's belief plus trust. All right? For everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, for in it, that is in the gospel, the righteousness of the law, oh, it doesn't say that, does it? The righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith as it is written, but the righteous man shall live by faith. Now, if you have a marginal reference Bible, you'll see there's an alternate translation that is just as accurate in Greek. And I think both are correct, but according to Paul's theology, the marginal reference should be the main text in my interpretation. And it goes like this. But he who is righteous by faith shall live. One says, you're righteous and you're going to live by faith. The other translation says, you become righteous by your faith. And going back to verse 5, which is the key, he's talking about how to become obedient, you know, the obedience of faith. So that's what I think is the correct one there. Now, the rest of chapter 1, I'd like to go through fairly fast, but it's vitally important. And if there are some Seventh-day Adventists here, and all of us need to understand what's going on here, and I'm going to kind of summarize it. Paul is saying that there is a knowledge about God that we get from creation. And it's about his divine nature and his eternal deity. And if we don't accept that, we begin to go down a slippery slope. And then in verse 19, because that which is known about God is evident within them, for God made it evident, so there is a certain amount of natural revelation. And then verse 21, though they knew about God but did not honor him as God, they became futile in their speculations. Verse 23, they exchanged the glory of the incorruptible God for an image. Notice they exchanged it. Verse 24, God gave them over to the lusts of their heart, to the impurity. Verse 25, they exchanged the truth of God for a lie. Verse 26, God gave them over to degrading passions. So what's the theme here? If we know truth and we don't follow it, we're starting down a slippery slope. That applies to any of us. We must have a clear conscience and we must be confronted by truth. And if we understand truth and say, well, you know, I don't think I really want to do that right now, it's a dangerous position. We need to be honest with ourselves and with the conscience. That I think is where the Holy Spirit speaks to us. All right. Okay, I think I'm going to skip down now to chapter 2. Therefore, you have no excuse, every one of you who pass judgment. See, first he says the Gentiles are guilty of death because they turned their back on the little knowledge they did have. And now he's talking to moral people. And he says, you know, you folks who think you have all the truth, be careful because when you judge others, you are probably judging yourself. I would want to just say this one thing, and I say it to me. And if the shoe fits, put it on your foot, okay? We as formers have come from a church that believed they were the only true church. We must be very careful that we don't develop a theology and judge everybody by our theology. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't be accurate in our theology, but we have to be careful not to condemn others, okay? And I think there's a tendency, or there could be a tendency for us to do that. And so we got to be careful that in our seeking for truth, we don't condemn others. Okay?